Today we will study the working and application of some of the special purpose diodes, and then we will move on to transistors. As you know, one of the major application of a diode is that it is used for rectification, that is conversion of AC to DC, but there are so many other applications for PN junctions, and today we will see some of such applications, namely Zener diode, photodiode, that is optoelectronic devices. So first we shall see what is a Zener diode. Now a Zener diode is a heavily doped PN junction having a very thin depletion region at the middle. As you know, a PN junction will have at the time of doping itself, a depletion layer will be formed due to diffusion. That is, at the P side you will have negative ions, and on the N side you will have positive ions. Now the concentration of these immobile ions at this junction will be determined by the concentration of doping of this both P and N materials. Now here it is a special purpose diode. As I told you, it is a special purpose diode, or in other words, this diode is fabricated in order to perform some special activities. Now here the major application of a Zener diode is using it as a regulator, a simple voltage regulator, voltage regulator. It is used as a voltage regulator. Now again the characteristic is similar to that of an ordinary diode. Because of this very huge doping of P and N, at the junction you will have a very very thin depletion layer. As a result, as I already told you, due to the formation of this depletion layer in the junction, you have an electric field. Now since this is fabricated in such a way that you have a very thin depletion layer, and also depletion layer due to the heavy doping, since the depletion layer thickness is very small, a very huge electric field of the order of 10 raised to 6 volt per meter is developed there. Now because of this very huge electric field developed there, Zener breakdown can take place even at very low voltages. As you know, in an ordinary diode this breakdown will be there, which we may call as avalanche breakdown. That breakdown takes place at a few hundreds of volts, but in this case, that is in the specially made diode, namely Zener diode, the breakdown, Zener breakdown takes place at very low voltages, say even 2 to 3 volt. So and that occurs because of the very huge electric field developed at the PN junction. Now this particular breakdown occurring is under electric field, or it is in fact an internal field emission. As a result, if you say restore the voltage back, that is if the reverse voltage applied is less than VZ, the device can stay back to its original condition. Whereas in an ordinary diode, when an avalanche breakdown takes place at as I told you, it is at few hundreds of volts. Now once it is taking place, it is also called peak reverse voltage. The voltage at which the breakdown takes place in an ordinary diode is called peak reverse voltage or peak inverse voltage. When such a breakdown takes place, the diode will be becoming useless. But in the case of a Zener diode, here because of the internal field emission, the device is intact even after breakdown. So that is, at breakdown you can see that the current steeply increases on the reverse direction. But once you remove this voltage, reverse voltage applied there, that is if VZ is becoming lower, the device will come back to its original condition. So this particular property of this diode can be used to making this as a simple voltage regulator. So this is the very basic idea of a Zener diode, and as we pass on to questions, we will discuss it more. Next we will see the application. As I have told you, the application of a Zener diode is constructing simple voltage regulators. So here in this figure you can see the simple voltage regulator using a Zener diode. Now here we have an unregulated power supply, that means a rectifier. Now the Senna diode is connected in parallel with that unregulated power supply, and you have the load resistance here. Now, in between the Senna diode and the unregulated power supply, you have used a resistance there, and that is a series resistor. In fact, the remainder of the unregulated voltage will be dropping across that, because you know if a very huge voltage comes in this unregulated power supply, the diode may not be capable of handling that. As a result, there is a chance for damage of the Senna diode. So, in order to avoid that, we use a series resistor always when you use the Senna diode to regulate a given voltage. So, this is the simple voltage regulator. Remember, the here the load is given as within the design limits, the load resistors sees a constant voltage regardless of the current. So, a design limit is there. As you know, breakdown, reverse breakdown occurs at a certain voltage VZ. So, that means the Senna diode can be used as a voltage regulator if only the unregulated power supply delivers a voltage more than the VZ value of this particular Senna diode. Because if it is less than that, you cannot make use of the reverse breakdown voltage region. Now, here one thing to be seen is that the Senna diode is connected in the reverse bias mode, because here is the, this is the symbol of the Senna diode, and it is connected in such a way that positive is connected to the cathode and negative is connected to the anode. So, the Senna diode is always used in the reverse bias mode. So, next we will go to another application of a PN junction, namely photodiode. Now, photodiodes are, in fact, as I have mentioned earlier, PN junction will have a property to convert electrical energy to light energy, as well as light energy to electrical energy. In fact, photodiode and solar cell both are converting light energy to electrical energy, whereas in LED it is converting electrical energy to light energy. So, here we have a photodiode. A photodiode means again a PN junction. We can see there a PN junction with a depletion layer here. Now, the very basic principle of working of a photodiode is that when a photon, that is a light radiation, is incident on this junction. So, in order to have a free incidence of this photons or radiation into the junction, some precautions will be taken in this fabrication. So, here as you can notice here, a window will be provided so that incident light can say go into the PN junction. So, once the radiation falls on the PN junction, electron hole pairs are produced at the depletion layer. Now, they will move towards their respective electrodes. As a result, you will get electricity from that photodiode. And photodiode can be used as photodetectors. That is, in order to detect light radiations, we can make use of photodiodes. Now, if you go to the application side, you can see that they are used in counters, then burglar alarms, etcetera. We can have the photodiode, because once the light is say obstructed here, the current flow will be limited. So, the light coming out of this electricity passing through the circuit will be dependent on the light radiation incident on the PN junction. So, the characteristic of a photodiode is given there. We need not go into the details of that, but it is also again used in the reverse bias mode. Generally, it is used in the reverse bias mode, so that here it is given as a dark current. Dark current means without any light radiation incident there. For a PN junction, as you know, there will be a reverse bias current, that is called the reverse saturation current. It is there, and that is called the dark current. Now, as light falls there, you can see that the amount of current passing through the junction increases because of the electron hole pair production. Now, as the intensity increases, more and more current comes there. So, the next application is light emitting diodes. You might have seen LEDs of different colors, as you can see in this picture. We can have red LEDs, yellow LEDs, green LEDs, blue, even white is now available. But in the very ancient times, we can have only red and green LEDs. But here, as the technology developed, we can construct say any type of material. We can fabricate PN junctions with compound materials which can have a forbidden energy gap in a very large range. So, that in fact, as you know, in a photodiode or LED or a solar cell in all the cases. Now, what happens is it is in the depletion layer, the electron hole pair production occurs, and in LEDs what is happening is the reverse of that, that is recombination of electrons and holes due to the high electric field that you apply. Recombination of electrons and holes takes place. Now, during this recombination, the excess energy is released in the form of light. That is why light is emitted by this diode, whereas in the other case the phenomenon is exactly reverse. In a photodiode, by injecting photons into it, you release electron hole pairs, that is from the valence band to the conduction band. Electrons will be removed from the valence band and they will reach the conduction band. So, at the conduction band you will have an electron. When an electron is going to the conduction band, a corresponding hole is created in the valence band. So, it is electron hole pair production. Now, here in this case what happens is in the depletion layer, the recombination of electrons and holes takes place in the LED, and that will create or that will generate light, that is the corresponding frequency photon will be emitted. As you know, the equation equation connecting this phenomenon is that Eg is the forbidden energy gap. Now, in fact, this energy is released or say absorbed, that is both the cases will be there, energy release or energy absorb is Eg, that is the band gap energy of the material with which this P and N are constructed decides how much energy is released or how much energy is required to produce that electron hole pair. So, that is equal to h nu or less than or equal to, h nu will be less than or equal to Eg in the case of LEDs, because some part of the Eg may not be available with the photons emitted there, it may be lost as heat. In such a case, it may be less than or equal to, h nu will be less than or equal to Eg in the case of LEDs. Or generally, that is at the extreme condition, what you have is Eg is equal to h nu will decide the, Eg is equal to h nu will decide the color of the, because you know here Eg is equal to h nu, nu means c by lambda, h c by lambda. So, the wavelength of the light emitted from the LED is decided by what the value of Eg, and Eg in the visible range, if it goes from 1.8 electron volt, Eg 1.8 electron volt to 3 electron volt is Eg having value in the range 1.8 electron volt to 3 electron volt will be usually lying in the visible range. Or materials which can have a forbidden energy gap in this range 1.8 to 3 electron volt can be used for constructing LEDs. And the color, of course, you know, color is decided by wavelength. So, the color of the LED is determined by the value of Eg of the material. So, if you want a green light, so corresponding to that wavelength, you have to select such a material which has an Eg corresponding to the green wavelength, which satisfies this relation. Similarly, and previously as I have told you, only red LEDs were available because the technology was not capable enough to have the different Eg values, so to fabricate materials having different Eg values which can satisfy all these wavelength ranges. But now we can have even white LEDs. So, LEDs are in the here I have shown you the light emission process in the LED, that is here as you can notice that electron at the p-n junction, electron hole recombination takes place. Now, during this electron hole recombination, the minority carriers on the p side, that is electrons, they will move to the n side due to the heavy electric field. So, because of this movement, electron hole pair combination, recombination takes. Now, during that recombination, whatever be the difference in energy, that is equal to the energy gap, that will be released in the form of photons. Now, the circuit and an LED is usually forward biased to have a high current flowing through this p-n junction, and it is in fact this high current which produces the recombination of electrons and holes. Then we will move on to solar cells. As you know, solar cells are devices which converts solar energy, so that is solar radiation when incident on those cells generates electrons. In fact, the working principle is similar to that of photodiode. Here also what is done is incident radiation, solar radiation incident on this PN junction, again these solar cells are, in fact this is the solar cell. Now, you can, as you can see, it is a PN junction. What is there inside is a PN junction, and proper metal contacts will be there at the top and bottom of this cells in order to take the electrons or collect the electron hole pairs which are generated there, and that will be given to the load. Now, a very simple schematic diagram of this solar panel is given here. A solar panel, as I have told you, the working principle is similar to that of photodiodes. So, here also when we have say light radiations incident on this solar panel, of course, in order to have maximum light entering into the solar panel, the fabrication will be, or the technology will be sufficiently say capable enough to allow light to come to this PN junction. So, in the PN junction, when light enters, we can have photons are coming to the PN junction and electron hole pair will be produced, and they will move to the respective electrodes to and you can collect it and save it on a battery or using inverters, etcetera. You can say save the electricity in a battery, and that can be used, or we can directly give it to the load, so that the electricity can be used to say give energy to the load that you connect here. So, that is the solar cell. So, with this very basic introduction, let us move to the questions. Now, the first question, a Zener diode is always used in the options are forward bias mode to attain rectification, forward bias mode to act as voltage regulator, reverse bias mode to act as voltage regulator, reverse bias mode to attain rectification, reverse bias mode for regulation, and forward bias mode for rectification. So, at the beginning itself, I have told you that a Zener diode is always used in the reverse bias mode. That is, plus will be applied here and minus will be. I told you the application of a Zener diode is to regulate voltage, because we are making use of the this region of the, that is the reverse breakdown region VZ of this reverse characteristic. So, the application is that this diode, in fact, you know, a diode can be used as a rectifier when you use it in the forward bias mode. So, the of course, the application of a Zener diode is not for rectification. Rectification means to convert AC to DC, that is done by an ordinary diode. Now, a Zener diode is used to say regulate or to make steady or to get a steady voltage which is obtained by obtained at the output of a rectifier. So, the application of a Zener diode is that it is used to regulate the, so it is used as a very simple voltage regulator to make a steady DC voltage, and always it is used in the reverse bias mode, because I have told you we have to make use of this region. Now, this is possible if only the Zener diode is used in the reverse bias mode. So, the correct choice is C, reverse bias mode to act as a voltage regulator. Next question, ordinary diodes undergo reverse breakdown only at a reverse bias voltage of a few hundreds, while Zener diodes undergo reverse breakdown at very low voltage, that is approximately 5 volt, even less than that. This is because a Zener diode has high electric field developed at the PN junction even at low voltages. Next option, a very thin depletion region. Third option, P and N regions are heavily doped. D, all the options A, B and C are correct. E, options A and B are correct in the case of a Zener diode. Now, as I have mentioned in the introduction itself, the huge electric field developed at the PN junction of the Zener diode is the reason for making breakdown even at very low voltages. So, answer A is correct. Then B, a very thin depletion region. Now, how this high electric field is developed at the PN junction due to the small application of small potential applied on that PN junction? It is because of the thin depletion region developed there. So, the B is also correct in the case of a Zener diode, because Zener breakdown occurs because of the electric field, and that electric field occurs because of the very thin depletion region. Then C, p-n regions are heavily doped. Why this thin depletion region developed? Because it is heavily doped. So that means all the three options are correct. So the answer is D, that is all the options A, B and C are correct. High electric field is developed at the depletion, as I have mentioned earlier. Next, we shall move to the next question. A simple Senner regulated power supply uses a Senner diode with VZ equal to 5 volt and PZ, that is power of the power rating of the Senner diode, equal to 400 milliwatt. The load current is to be 20 milliampere and the unregulated DC input is 10 volt. The minimum value of a series resistor to be used in it is, that is what is we have to calculate. So, we have a simple Senner regulator. So, we can, as I have shown you earlier, a simple Senner regulator means it is like this. Now, this is the series resistor RS and here we have the load resistor and this is the Senner which will have a breakdown voltage of VZ. Now, here we give the unregulated DC supply with the positive here and negative here. So, in the question, the Senner diode has VZ equal to 5 volt and PZ means the power of the Senner diode, that is given to be 400 milliwatt. So, you know PZ is equal to what? PZ is equal to VZ into IZ, that is the Senner current. Therefore, IZ is equal to PZ by VZ, which is equal to 400 milliwatt divided by 5 volt, that is equal to 80 milliampere, milliwatt by volt. So, it is 80 milliampere, IZ is 80 milliampere. Now, you are asked to find out what is the value of RS so that you have to deliver 20 milliampere to the load. That is IL is equal to, the load current IL is equal to 20 milliampere, it is given in the question. So, we need, this is the, if I take IS, the current flowing through this, that is current to be coming from the unregulated power supply through RS, then this current is to be regulated in such a way that through this we need how much IZ, that is 80 milliampere. So, this is IZ and through this you need the load current IL, because the load current is required to be, the load current is to be 20 milliampere. So, here IL is equal to what? 20 milliampere, IZ is equal to 80 milliampere. Now, we can see that IS is equal to what? IS is equal to IL plus IZ, that is equal to IL is 20 plus 80, that is equal to 100 milliampere. So, that is the total current. So, you are asked to find out what is the series resistor that you have to put there and what is the voltage appearing across this, the unregulated say DC voltage. If I take it as V in, unregulated DC voltage, if I take it as V in, then V in minus V Z is equal to the voltage across RS. Therefore, V in is equal to, what is it, IS RS plus VZ, this voltage is appearing here also, right. So, what is required is RS. Therefore, RS is equal to V in minus VZ divided by IS, and IS we have calculated to be, IS is 100 milliampere, already I have shown you 100 milliampere. Therefore, RS is equal to V in is, you know, the unregulated DC power supply delivers 10 volt. So, 10 minus 5 divided by IS is 100, 10 minus 5 volt by 100 milliampere, or that is equal to 100 milliampere means 100 into 10 raised to minus 3. So, that is equal to 5 divided by 100 into 10 raised to minus 3, right, milliampere when you convert, or that is equal to 5000 by 100, or that is equal to 50 ohm. So, the right choice is E, 50 ohms. So, that is the correct option here. Now, we shall go to the next question. The question is, a semiconductor device which is not a optoelectronic device is. Now, the options given here are photodiode, solar cell, light emitting diode, Zener diode and semiconductor laser. So, it is clear that Zener diode is not an optoelectronic device means a device which works with optical energy and electrical energy, or say a device which will have both optical energy and electrical energy coming in the picture. So, as I have told you, photodiode, solar cell are say converting light energy to electrical energy, whereas light emitting diode is the reverse, and semiconductor laser is also again a p-n junction which produces light. So, except Zener diode, all others are optoelectronic devices. So, the answer is D, Zener diode. Next question. The principle of operation of a photodiode is, the options are there. I have already told you that the principle I have already mentioned, that generation of electron hole pairs due to absorption of photons. So, the correct option is A. Next question. The band gap energy of semiconductor used for the fabrication of visible LEDs must be in the range. Say the options are 0.7 electron volt to 5 electron volt, 1.1 electron volt to 2.5 electron volt, 0.3 electron volt to 2.4 electron volt, 1.8 to 3 and 1 eV to 5 eV. Now, the band gap energy of semiconductor used for the fabrication of visible LEDs. Visible LEDs means, see, you know, visible light means in the wavelength range approximately 400 nanometer to 700 nanometer is usually the visible wavelength range. So, we have Eg is equal to h nu or h c by lambda. So, if you substitute lambda to be 400 nanometer, you get the lowest wavelength range corresponding to which you get the Eg value, or the highest Eg value required for selecting a material for visible LED you will get. And if you substitute lambda to be 700, then you will get the lowest value of Eg, right. So, the on doing that, you are, in fact, if you do that, it is the substitute the value of H, C, and I am not going to that. Substituting values of H is Planck's constant, C is the velocity of light, and lambda these two values. So, if you substitute the values, you get the corresponding energy in SI unit, then you convert it into electron volt, and you can see that the value obtained is of in the range 1.8 electron volt to 3 electron volt is the range of values of Eg which is required. So, the correct option here is D, 1.8 electron volt to 3 electron volt. Now, we shall move to the next question. The semiconductor used for the fabrication of an LED has a band gap energy 1.8 electron volt. The predominant color of light emitted by the LED is. Now, you know how to find that. Again, this formula is sufficient. You have to, you have given the band gap energy, Eg is given. Eg is equal to 1.8 eV, or that is equal to 1.8 into 1.6 into 10 raised to minus 19 joule. So, you are asked to find out what is the wavelength of light. If you assume that the complete energy is utilized for getting light, or the, say there is no loss of energy in this LED production, then I can assume that the complete energy is used for producing light. So, corresponding lambda I can calculate. So, lambda is equal to Eg by, sorry, Hc, lambda is equal to Hc by Eg, or that is equal to, on calculating it, you will get lambda to be, again so you can substitute and calculate the value. Lambda is found to be 6.63 into 10 raised to minus 34 into 3 into 10 raised to 8 divided by Eg is 1.8 into 1.6 into 10 raised to minus 19. So, on substitution, you will be getting it as 6.9 into 10 raised to minus 7, or that is equal to 690 nanometer, approximately 700 nanometer. 690 nanometer means it is the color is red. 690 nanometer is that is from the spectral data. You can see that this wavelength corresponds to almost red. So, the color of the light emitted by the LED will be red. The answer is E. So, now we shall move to the next question. A solar cell is different from a photodiode because the options are: their working principles are different. B, solar cell converts light energy to electrical energy while photodiode converts electrical energy to light energy. C, solar cell converts electricity to light and photodiode converts light to electricity. Just whatever B, the complementary of B option is that. D, solar cell has no external bias and has large junction area compared to photodiodes. E, electron hole pairs are produced in photodiodes whereas electrons are produced, only electrons are produced in solar cells. So, as it is trivial that the first option, the solar cell working principle are different, that is wrong. I have told you solar cell, photodiode, etcetera are having the same principle, electron hole pair production is there. So, here in this case the correct option is D, solar cell has no external bias and has large junction area compared to photodiodes. Now, see, as I have told you, a photodiode is again both of them are p-n junctions and in the depletion layer light is allowed to be incident. So, electron hole pair production happens there. Now, a photodiode is used with a reverse bias. See, I have told you the dark current, etcetera. So, a photodiode has an external bias and the application of a photodiode is essentially to detect optical signals, whereas the application of a solar cell is to generate electricity. Therefore, there will be in the fabrication itself there will be some slight difference that here the junction area will be limited because say we allow light to incident there and because of the incident light some current, reverse current will flow through that and that can be the current flowing through that is proportional to the intensity of light. So, that can be used to, or the intensity of light can be evaluated using this current flowing through that. So, such applications are there for this photodiode, whereas in the case of a solar cell what is required is to generate electricity. Therefore, as much say electron hole pair production must be there, therefore, you will have a very huge p-n junction, that is the junction area is made very large in order to have say a huge amount of light collected there. And also notice that no external bias is there. This is the energy generated is generally say taken and it is either directly connected to the load or it is used to charge a battery there. So, no external bias is required in a solar cell, whereas in a photodiode external biasing is there. So, the correct option is cell has no external bias and has large junction area compared to photodiodes. Now, we shall see the basic principle of action of a transistor and then we will try to do some problems based on the transistor application. Now, as you know there are two types of transistors, namely NPN transistor and PNP transistor. Now, in an NPN transistor you have emitter made up of N material and the base region is made of P and collector is again N, whereas in PNP transistor emitter is P, base is N and collector is P. Now, here you can notice that the fabrication or manufacturing of a transistor is in such a way that the base region is made very thin and this is in order to collect all the carriers emitted by the emitter reaching the collector, in order to make it possible that almost 99% of the emitters, the carriers emitted by the emitter should reach the collector. And in fact, the purpose of the base or the region of the base, N region, opposite region which is there in the base is doing a controlling process. Now, transistor means transverse resistor, that is a controlling of carrier flow from emitter to collector is done by the base region. And you have to see that we can have a transistor is having so many applications. You are familiar with amplifiers, oscillators, then such another things. That is a transistor. A transistor is basically used in most of the electronic circuits. So, the whole application of transistors can be generally classified into two groups, namely amplifying action and switching action. Now, amplifying action means, say if you look at the characteristic of a transistor, that is and again a transistor can be used in three different modes, namely common emitter, common base and common collector. Of the three different modes, common emitter mode is widely used because of so many advantages of that common emitter mode over the other two, that is common base and common collector. We are not going into that details. Anyway, if you look at the common emitter mode, you can see that the characteristic is if you look at the output characteristic. Output characteristic means the output current against the output voltage. So if you plot VCE against IC, the shape of the graph will be like this. That is for common emitter mode, the collector current against collector emitter voltage. If you plot it, you can see that this is the shape of the graph for different base currents. That is say in a common emitter mode, IE equal to say 2 milliampere, 4 milliampere, etcetera. Now, you can see that in this characteristic curve, now the region here, you can have a cutoff region, then saturation region, and the region coming here is what is called the active region of the characteristic. Now, in fact, if you are using a transistor, so such that the operating point is or the working point is in this active region, you call it as an amplifier. And if it is either say cutoff or saturation region, then it is called a switching action, or that is what I told you earlier, that a transistor has only two basic type of application, namely amplifying action, that is we are making use of the active region of the transistor characteristics, and then switching action, where you are making use of the cutoff region or the saturation region. Now, as you know, previously most of the transistors which were available in the market were used for amplifying purpose. Amplifying purpose, when I say amplifying purpose, I does not mean amplifier alone. Oscillator is again coming under amplifier. Amplifier with a positive feedback is what is called a oscillator. So, for amplifying purpose, if a transistor is used for a amplifying purpose, you are making use of the active region of the transistor. So, previously most of the transistors were used in that, or were using the active region of the transistor, where the switching mode is comparatively less in application. But nowadays, as digital electronics become more and more popular, the application of a transistor as a switch has gained momentum. So, what is the advantage of a transistor switch over a mechanical switch? Definitely the switching time. Here we need the switching time required is of the order of only a few nanoseconds in the case of transistors, micro or nanoseconds, whereas for a mechanical switch it cannot be there. So, the switching time is the, because we know that nowadays computers are becoming more and more faster, and you know that is because of the capability of the transistor to switch from that cutoff mode to saturation mode within a nanosecond. So, the reason for say using a transistor as a switch is very clear, that very fast switching is possible here. So, in digital electronics, how much fastness you can achieve, that will be good for the digital electronic circuit. So, we are fabricating transistors with fast switching time, so that the switching application has has a lot of applications, and almost amplifying action and switching action are in equal footing. This is NPN. Conventional current flow is from base to emitter. This is emitter, collector and base, and for a PNP transistor it is opposite. For a PNP transistor, it is conventional current is towards base, and for an NPN transistor it is reverse. Now, in the figure it was given as a mistake. Now, here we have a circuit that is a switching circuit is shown in the figure, where you have a base bias given by VBB, then collector bias given by VCC. RB, RC are the two resistors used in the base region and the collector region. Now, these potentials, that is VCE, VBE, etcetera, will be used for studying the working of a transistor, that we can do when we come to problems. So, I think we can directly enter into problems. The relative doping level of emitter, base and collector region of a transistor are respectively, the options are there. Now, if you come to this figure, you can see that the function of the emitter is to emit carriers, and the carriers emitted by the emitter will be collected by the collector here. And as I told you earlier, base region will control the flow of these carriers from emitter to collector. Therefore, it is clear that emitter must be heavily doped, so that large amount of carriers can be emitted from there, and collector will be moderately doped to accommodate it. Then the base region is in such a way that it should be very low doping, because if it is heavily doped, there is a chance of recombination of the emitters from this emitter region to the base region. At that case, what happens is the carriers emitted from the emitter will not reach the collector. That is, the output may not be available. It will be say circulating in this path only. So, in order to avoid that, the base region must be of low doping. Or the correct answer here is heavy, low, moderate. D is the correct option. Now, the next question: the biasing arrangements of the emitter, base, and collector regions of a transistor are such that the options are: the base emitter is always forward biased and base collector is reverse biased. The base emitter is forward biased, so I shall explain that. The base emitter is always forward biased and base collector is always reverse biased. Now, there is a mistaken notion among students that base emitter is forward biased and base collector is reverse biased always. It is not like that. Depending on the application for which the transistor is employed to, the biasing will vary. Now, as I have told you, in the ancient times, most of the application of the transistors were amplifying action, so that the operating point must be at the active region. For that, this type of biasing is there. But as, if you generally say, then depending on the application, you have to bias it. So, the option, the base emitter is forward biased and base collector is reverse biased only for amplifying action. That is the correct option, that is B. The base emitter is forward biased and base collector is reverse biased only for amplifying action. That is, if amplifying is the purpose, then the base emitter is forward biased and base collector is reverse biased. Now, we shall move to the next question. A base current of 10 microampere flows through a transistor when the emitter current is 1 milliampere. The beta value of the transistor is approximately. Now, you have studied that beta is the current amplification factor in the case of a, beta is the current amplification factor in CE mode. Now, here as and from the theory, it is already been studied that beta is equal to delta IC by delta IB for AC, and for DC, beta DC is equal to IC by IB. So, it is a very simple problem. Here what is given is the DC current, DC collector current and DC base current are given. You are asked to find out what is the beta value. So, beta is equal to IC by IB, and here what are given is IE is equal to 1 milliampere and IB is equal to 10 microampere. This is the values given. In order to find beta, you need IC and IB. IB is directly given. Here IC is required, but IE is given. You know, IE means emitter current. Emitter current is equal to base current plus collector current. Because in a transistor, see, as I have told you, say emitter, base and collector. This is NPN transistor. So, emitter, the duty of the emitter is to emit carriers. Even though the base is made very thin, a very small portion of the current will flow to the base and the other will escape to the collector. So, in fact, IE is equal to IB plus IC, but IB, since it is very small, you can approximately take it as equal to what? Equal to IC. Or if you want an accurate value, you can say subtract IC from in order to, you can subtract IB from IE to get what? IC. So, that way also you can do. Now, here we need an approximate only. That is, the beta value of the transistor is approximately. So, that means I take this IE is approximately equal to IC. Therefore, beta is equal to what? Therefore, beta is equal to IC by IB equal to what? Equal to IC is what? Equal to IE, which is equal to 1 milliampere. So, 1 milliampere divided by 10 microampere. So, when you say convert this units, you will get the result as equal to 100. 1 milliampere is 1000 microampere. 1000 microampere by 10 microampere means it is 100. So, the result is 100. So, the correct answer here is C, 100. So, we shall do the next question. Two amplifiers connected one after the other in series has a voltage gain of 10 and 20. An input signal of 100 microvolt is given at the first stage. The value of the output voltage at the second stage is, the options are there. So, we have two amplifiers cascaded together. That is, you have amplifier 1, amplifier 2. Now, an input signal is given here, which has an input signal of 100 microvolt. 100 microvolt is given here. Now, the gain of the amplifiers are given as 10 and 20. That is, A1 is 10 and A2 is 20. Now, if a 100 microvolt signal comes at the input of this first amplifier, what will be the output here? So, the output is required. So, at the first stage, you get what? We know gain of the amplifier is equal to what? Gain is equal to voltage gain is equal to output voltage by input voltage, output voltage by input voltage. So, here the voltage gain for the first stage, 100 microvolt is given there. So, that in the first stage, 100 into 10 microvolt will be appearing here, right? That will be acting as the input for the second. Therefore, the overall output will be 10 into 20, next that will be again multiplied by 20 to get the output. So, the overall gain is equal to, overall gain is equal to 10 into 20. Therefore, output voltage is equal to overall gain into input voltage, overall gain into input, that is equal to 200 into input is 100 microvolt. 200 into 100 microvolt means it is this much microvolt, or that is equal to 20 millivolt. So, the correct option here is C, 20 millivolt. So, today we have seen some of the applications of special purpose diodes, namely Zener diode, photodiode, LEDs and solar cells. And then we have seen the working of a transistor, and we have done a few problems on transistors also. I hope that you have enjoyed it. Thank you very much.